You might have heard of Azure Blob Storage, but what is it and what can you use it for and how do you get started? Learn all about it this week on Data Exposed MVP Edition. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by Indira, an MVP in New Zealand, I believe. Indira, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Hi, my name is Indira, and I have been in the data space for almost 20 years now, working on SQL Server, business intelligence, now more on Azure. In my pastime, I actually do teach kids all about SQL and Power BI. I have been doing that since 2016. And I think that's what got me the MVP award from Microsoft. So that's a brief about me.
Awesome. Cool. Well, we're excited to have you on the show. And I also think it's really cool that you're kind of teaching the next generation all about SQL and Power BI. But today we're going to be talking about Azure Blob Storage. And surprising to some of our viewers, this isn't something we've ever talked about on the show before. So I'd love to kick it off before you tell us all about it. Like, can you tell us why should like a data person or SQL Server, Azure SQL, whatever person care about Azure Blob Storage? And then, yeah, let's learn all about it.
Okay, so I'll keep this very brief. The main reason why SQL Server people should care about blob storage is SQL Server mostly deals with structured data, but with Azure Blob Storage, we can store all the unstructured data, which means the media files like and documents, the PowerPoint, the Word documents, and the Parquet files. All kinds of files can be stored in the blob storage.
Cool.
So shall I get started?
Yeah, let's learn all about it.
Okay. So first, today's agenda is we will learn a bit about what Azure Blob Storage is, and I will do a quick demo. So as I mentioned, Azure Blob Storage is a Microsoft-provided service on Azure, and then it is used for optimized for storing different documents, and that's why it is called blob, which is large objects, and we can store large objects which are unstructured, and they are stored as text or binary. And blob storage is designed for, as you can see on the screen, serving images or documents directly to a browser, storing for files for distributed access, streaming video and audio, and writing to log files, storing data for backup, restore, disaster recovery, and archiving, and also storing data for analysis by an on-premise or Azure-hosted service. Azure hosted service.
Cool.
And blob storage offers three types of resources, which is the storage account, container in the storage account, and a blob in a container. So what exactly I mean by this is you have three roles. For example, I am a user. I'm Sally, let's say, and I have these large number of files that I need to store, like pictures, movies. And so that's why I create a container to store those images or movies or whatever documents that I want to share, I want to store. And it also provides a secure way to store all your pictures and movies, and all the large objects are stored in a blob. So what I mean by it is if you have lot of documents, you can upload them into a container, and because you are the user, the account will be owned by you, and you can share these resources by using APIs, REST APIs, or PowerShell, or command line interface, or even certain libraries from .NET. All these can be accessed to using those things. So,
cool. Before we get into a demo, because I saw that on the agenda and I'm excited about it, quick question. Like, when we say container, like, super familiar with containers, but this isn't like a you know, small hosted container that people think of, like this is more like a folder, or can you explain?
Yeah, it's more? A folder. So yeah. And you can, once you create a Azure Blob Storage on the portal, Azure portal, you can also access using what is called a small tool called Storage Explorer. So you can connect your subscription to the Storage Explorer, and then it will be like a folder structure, like how you have Windows Explorer.
Cool.
So
awesome.
you can use that. You can use a familiar structure to access those.
Nice. Let's take a look at what you have.
I'm logging into the portal with my login credentials, and here is the portal that you can see. Now, in the portal, the storage accounts are available as a resource. So in order to create a resource, click on Create Resource and search for storage account. And once the storage account pops up, then you can click on it and choose the green one, which is the storage account. Once you choose the storage account, you can just hit on Create. And here you can see a lot of tabs. So choose the subscription first, and also I prefer creating a new resource so that when you want to delete, you can just delete the resource group. So I'm creating a new resource group, and you can also name the storage account name. So I'm just giving DE because data exposed. So, and it also makes sure that it is unique. So, and then you can choose the region, because I'm from New Zealand. The New Zealand data center is not yet there. So I'm using Australia East. And also here performance is either standard or premium. I just use the standard, and there are different redundancies, local redundancy storage, geo-redundant, all those things. So just choose the geo-redundant for starting access and make read access. I just tick that and then click the next. And in the advanced tab, you have the security where you can define. So require security transfer for REST APIs. If you don't want, you can untick those. I'm just keeping everything normal. And you can use the TLS version. The latest version is 1.2. And if you want to scope the permitted scope for copy operations, you can change those as well. I'm just keeping the defaults. And now network access, at the moment I just put the enable public access, but you can give private access only, and then based on what you are sharing, you can do this thing. And then you can put the data protection as well, so which will define your sensitive information. And also tracking, if you want to track the who is accessing, that also you can do that. And encryption type also you can mention. And I'm not mentioning anything. I'm just using the defaults. And you can add tags as well for search. And then you can review all your configuration, and then you can hit create. So and that takes about a couple of minutes. So once your deployment is complete, you will get a notification. And also you can hit on the go to resource. And here you will get an overview of all your configuration that you have created. And if you want to change, you can change from there itself. And there are different tabs. The monitoring tab will give you what total ingress and egress. And all the capabilities, you can use the blob storage to create a static website, lifecycle management, all these things. So you can secure data via private endpoints and things like that. And also Azure gives you recommendations, whether it is using Azure best practices or not. And based on that, you can correct your Azure storage, blob storage configuration. And you can use the client libraries from different and so here I have mentioned the containers. So here in the data storage section, you have the containers, and you can add a container like how I have mentioned. So I'm just naming the container as DE container 1, and you can specify the access level as well, private, anonymous, or container anonymous with and then blob anonymous. So you can do that. And in the advanced section, you can do the encryption configuration as well. I'm just keeping the thing as it is. So now, the container is created. It just took a couple of seconds. And then now this is the container, and this is where you can upload your files. So I'm just uploading a media file. And if you can tick overwrite if you want to. So, yeah. And then you can access it. I will show you the access as well, how to access. I'm just going to upload one more file, which is a Word file. And then, it just uploads very quickly. And now for you to access, you just click on the document that you want to access. And if you try the URL, copy the URL and try to access that, you will not have access because it is secure. So you need to generate a SAS token. So that's what I will show you now. So there is, if you come down, there is a generate SAS, and you can just click on that. If you want HTTPS and HTTP, you can choose that as well. If you choose the blob SAS token only, even then you cannot access, but you need to choose the blob storage URL, only then you will be able to access, which I think I'm going to show you a little bit. Just go again and then copy the blob SAS URL, and now it downloads for you. So it's downloaded, the document is downloaded. So that's about it that I have in the for the demo.
Nice, cool. That was super useful to kind of see end to end how you get this thing deployed, all the different options. Also pretty interesting how there's a lot of overlap in the different categories. Like a lot of those things looked familiar to what you would see when you're deploying something like Azure SQL Database. And then to see in action the containers and the blobs that you were mentioning about, just found it super useful. So Indira, thanks so much for coming on the show. Any final tips or tricks for folks who are just getting started with this?
Just getting started, I think you should start exploring and then see what works and what does not work. And there are a lot of media out there who are blogging and vlogging. So you can, and also Microsoft Learn provides a very good documentation, which you can start using it straight away. So that's awesome. My tip.
Cool. Well, thanks so much, Indira, for coming on the show. I learned a lot. I know our viewers learned a lot as well. To our viewers, if you like this episode, go ahead, give it a like. Let us know what you think of this episode. Follow the links in the description to learn more, and we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.